So hi everyone, welcome to Knock Knock Who's There, a peek into the world of woodpeckers. My name is Misha and I work with Early Bird, which is a project under the Education and Public Engagement Program of Nature Conservation Foundation. We work towards creating and disseminating creative educational content to introduce people to birds. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Ghazala Shahabuddin. Thanks a lot, Ghazala, for joining us today. Woodpeckers are one of the most conspicuous and popular group of birds that inhabit forests, parks, orchards, and gardens, wherever there are trees. They are known for their cavity building and bark leaning habits, and often referred to as ecosystem engineers. India itself harbors over 30 species, ranging in size and behavior, from the largest species, the great slaty, to the tiny speckled piculet. And based on her experience in the forests of the Himalayas, today Ghazala will take you through the natural history of woodpeckers, the peculiar behaviors of lesser known species, and the reason why they're often called keystone species. She will also explain why woodpeckers can provide early signals of deforestation in our changing world. A little bit about Ghazala. Ghazala is an ecologist and author. She's specially interested in forest birds and how various species are affected by human activities. She has carried out research projects on birds in the Western Ghats, Sariska Tiger Reserve in Rajasthan, Corbett Tiger Reserve, and since 2011 in the Himalayan oak forests. She currently works as a senior scientist with the Center for Ecology Development and Research, also called CEDAR, in Dehradun, and also runs a village-based nature training project in Kumaon. So thank you again, Ghazala, for being with us today.
Thank you.
Over to you. Oh, and I forgot to mention, there's also a quiz towards the end of the talk. So please stay tuned till then. There'll also be two bonus questions for which we'll be giving away prizes. All right, so I'll stop sharing my screen.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. It's, as I was telling Misha some time back, this is my first webinar and it's kind of unnerving not to see the people I'm talking to, but it's really good to know that there are about 200 people expected, and that's more people than I've ever talked to. So it's exciting. And thank you so much, the Early Bird team, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to talk about a pretty much ongoing set of thoughts and processes. And today, I'm basically just touching on a number of thoughts about woodpeckers. I'd like to mention at the outset that this talk really synthesizes a lot of data, a lot of concepts that me and my students and collaborators have developed over the last 15 years. I'd like to specially mention Tarun Menon and Raman Kumar, who've been really generous with their photographs. I'm a terrible photographer, I'm still learning. So it's wonderful that I'm able to use these fantastic pictures of theirs to illustrate what I'm saying. So woodpeckers, as we just said, there are species that, you see, people see the most. They are really conspicuous, they are loud. They are present almost everywhere, though I must say the really nice ones are not present everywhere, as we shall see. And my flavor of the season right now are the oak forests of Kumaon. I just wrote an article on the oak forest, which was published in Round Glass yesterday. It's really, really remarkable how much diversity there is. Since 2011, I've been visiting for a number of reasons, taking students for internships, just walking and watching birds, and slowly we developed some projects. And what we are finding is that the oak forests are really diverse. We have as many as 9 species of woodpeckers here. As you walk in the oak forest, you often hear a very, very strange sound. A lovely mysterious sound. And that's the drumming by a woodpecker. Often you think, oh, there must be a carpenter in the village nearby. It's such a forceful and a mechanical sound. But then you often see some woodpeckers flying out of those thick oak trees and other trees and going from one tree to another with their characteristic flight. Woodpeckers have this bounding flight pattern. They flap their wings a few times, rise, and then they close their wings and dip, taking advantage of gravity. It's a very different flight pattern from other species. And they'll often be calling, which will sometimes give away their identity. You look around and you hear a number of sounds, and the early morning woodpeckers are very active. So that's the Himalayan woodpecker, one of the most easily seen woodpeckers in the Himalayas. It is actually found only in the Himalayas, central and the western Himalayas, all the way up to Pakistan. And it's supposed to be really a different bird in the sense that it is one of the few woodpeckers that's actually found in pine forests. Most of the woodpeckers stay away from pine. You know, the pine forest has been romanticized a lot in our Indian movies, but unfortunately that's a forest which has very few birds living there. But the Himalayan woodpecker actually is able to crack into the pine cones and take away the seeds. And Ali and Ripley say that they actually store these seeds in the notches of the branches. That remains to be researched much more. But it's a beautiful bird. It has a black and white pattern and a lovely red vent. It's not very shy. But the bird that really takes the prize for the Himalayan oak forest is this bird. A lovely shrill call, and this is the beautiful bird that whose call it is. This is the rufous-bellied woodpecker, highly underrated woodpecker. I say that because there's very little written about the species, and yet it is really moderately common. It's easily seen in the oak forest, and it has, you'll see that its beak is much more pointed than the previous woodpecker that I showed you, the Himalayan woodpecker. That's because it specializes in feeding on tree sap of all things. Tree sap feeding is not very common globally. There are only a few species that do this. You may have heard of the North American sapsucker. So these are in the sapsucker subfamily of woodpeckers. They drill these holes, and then they have these very brush-like tongue that can go inside and lick up the sap that is coming out. So it is, this is the male, brilliantly colored. The female doesn't have the red head. It has the chestnut belly. It lives in pairs, and it really does stick to thick forest. It needs large trees and it needs thick forest. You won't see it in the parks and in the near the villages. This is an example of a tree that has been completely filled with holes by some pairs of rufous-bellied woodpeckers. The interesting part about this woodpecker, and which we really like, is that you're bound to see it. If you come to a tree like this, they're very territorial and they keep coming back for the sap. It's a really interesting behavior. What's important about this woodpecker is that it's the only woodpecker in India that does sap sucking. So it's a very different species from the rest. So coming back to woodpeckers, we are lucky to have as many as 32 species in India. It's almost 15% of the world total of 210. Now, compared to many other groups of birds, these are relatively few species. And within the woodpecker family, you have the true woodpeckers, such as the Himalayan. You have the sap suckers, like the rufous belly. You also have the piculets and wrynecks that belong in this family, but are little different in the way they make their living. India has a range of sizes. We have 32 species ranging from the speckled piculet, which is about 9 centimeters in length. It's a little bigger than your middle finger. To the gray-capped pygmy woodpecker, which is also very small. It's barely 14 centimeters. This is found in the foothills of the Himalayas all the way from the east to the western Himalayas, often seen in pairs, all the way to the real glamour girl of them all. This is the great slaty woodpecker. Those of you who have heard Raman Kumar's talk earlier would have seen some of these about this woodpecker. This is a woodpecker that is apparently common in sal forests. And when we did some work together in Corbett Park and in the Terai, and Raman did these back-breaking surveys, found that they were actually not as common as people thought they were. And they have huge home ranges. If you just take a look at the bill, these are 51 centimeters long. And as of today, they're actually the largest woodpecker of the world, you know. And we have the unique distinction of having all of these smallest to the largest woodpecker right in our own country. So now I'm going to ask you a question. You've seen these three woodpeckers, the speckled piculet, the gray-capped, and the great slaty. And now I'm going to play a call. You have to guess which of these has this call. So you can write in your answers in the chat box. So is this the speckled piculet? Is it the gray capped, or is it the great slaty? Wow, that's a lot of responses coming in. And it seems like a lot of people think it is all three species, so it's pretty much divided. But yeah, this is the speckled piculet. I have a nice note from Tarun here. It says that the call is so high-pitched that it's hard to hear in the field. It's this tiny bird that makes this really high-pitched call. Okay. Going ahead. So we have, being such tree-loving species, obviously woodpeckers love trees. So we have the maximum number of species in the rainforest and other moist forests, such as moist deciduous forest, sal forest. And you still have one or two species in the deserts and grasslands. There is a species in the southwestern United States that nests inside the cactus. So it's very much present in the desert. But on the whole, these are forest birds. And the thicker the forest and the taller the trees, the more woodpeckers you're going to get in the forest. That's one thing we have learned over the last 10 years. It's not a lot, I agree with you. The other very interesting part about woodpeckers is that a large majority of them are resident species. If you know about migratory species, a lot of the ducks that we have, a lot of cranes, they're all migratory species. They take an intercontinental migrations all the way from Siberia, Central Asia, North Asia, come all the way to India, go to Africa. But woodpeckers, on the other hand, are largely resident birds wherever they occur, except perhaps in the northern North America. In India, they are largely resident. And of course, there's always an exception to the rule. The Eurasian wryneck, which occurs in India, is migratory. It comes in from Northern Asia and goes in, and comes in winter and spends the winter in South Asia. Again, it's a bird that is seen much more on the ground than on the trees. It's a strange bird in many ways. What is interesting about being resident or non-migratory, a bird that doesn't migrate in winter? So how do the woodpeckers find enough food in winter? If you look at the Himalayas, you look at the northern parts of India, such as places like the Terai, it gets terribly cold in winter, where you would think there are no insects, but the woodpeckers are able to live through the winter. And we'll explore why. We also have a whole lot of endemic species. One of our commonest endemic species is the brown-fronted pied, which is endemic not to India, but to the western and central Himalayas. And some occur up to Pakistan. And it's actually, for an endemic species, it's rather common. It's found very easily. It is seen in orchards, gardens, village lots. But yes, it requires some trees, and it's able to, it doesn't get disturbed by human beings. One of the easier ones to see. So what are the two really key features of woodpeckers? One is that they're tree gleaners. Now, what does tree gleaning mean? You're basically going up and down the tree trunk or up and down the bark, the branches of trees, and gleaning out insects from under the bark, from under the leaves. You're prying open holes, you're looking for larvae. That is what is meant by a tree gleaner. There are other tree gleaners that we have, such as nuthatches. For those of you who are already birders, there are nuthatches, and there are tree creepers, which are also gleaners. Now, how does the woodpecker do all of this? You can just see the beak. Now, you wouldn't want to be on the wrong side of that beak, right? It's pretty sharp and strong. And with that beak, it's able to open up, make holes in the tree trunk. It also has special woodpecker feet with two toes pointing in front. Sorry, the arrows here are wrong. Toes 2 and 3 point in front and 1 and 4 point at the back. And so because of this, it's able to cling on the tree trunks and rapidly climb up and down, almost like an acrobat. They sometimes go right other way up as well, upside down, and very strong claws. Here you can see the tail of this gray-headed woodpecker. It is very strong. The strong, stiff tail feathers are a key feature of this family. Provide support to the bird when it's sitting on the tree trunk or climbing up and down. The other feature that distinguishes these birds is the cavity-making habit. So, very few other birds are able to create these cavities which the woodpeckers use for roosting as well as nesting. You can see this great slaty woodpecker female that is making this cavity. And you can see how easy it is for this woodpecker. Look at the beak. And the opening of the cavity is usually quite narrow, not more than 10 centimeters. It goes in horizontally and then it plunges down into an egg chamber where the adult can fit with the eggs, and they incubate the eggs there. Now, how on earth does it do this? A lot of people have said that if human beings tried to do this kind of cavity making, we would suffer concussion immediately. It hits the tree with a head with a speed of 6 meters per second, which works out to about 21 kilometers per hour. And some of the times while digging, it can hit the tree 20 times per second. We're not talking about minute, we're talking second. So you can imagine what the reflexes are like. The reason the woodpeckers are able to do this is because their head bones have spongy tissue which act as shock absorbers. And there is an extra bone that wraps right around the neck and around the head twice over, which provides it with an extra helmet to protect its brain. I think scientists are still trying to find out how this is done. It's truly remarkable. And of course, woodpeckers are real foodies. So far, we've seen woodpeckers on the trees, and we know that they're eating insects all of the time. So a trick question here for all of you. Do woodpeckers eat fruit at all? Can they eat fruit? So in the chat box, you can write your answer. Let's see what you think about fruits and woodpeckers. Yeah. Very good. I think 90% of the people say that they eat fruit. One person has actually written that they've seen woodpeckers feeding on jackfruit in Periyar. And I remember an occasion when I in the Western Ghats have seen the same thing, where they eat the flesh of the jackfruit. So yeah, these birds are actually, even though they're highly specialized for eating bark insects, they do eat fruit. We have seen them eat bark insects. We've seen them eat fruit, which can be berries. It can be flesh of the fruit, seeds. So a desperate bird in winter is going to do everything to get food. Later on, I'll show you how some woodpeckers even eat the hard acorn, the oak acorn. Tree sap, we've already talked about. Ants and termites. A number of woodpeckers you'll see sitting on the ground and say, what is it doing on the ground? It's supposed to be up on a tree. We've seen gray-headed woodpeckers and scaly-bellied woodpeckers and a number of other woodpeckers sitting on the ground and attacking ant hills and termite mounds. So birds are actually pretty opportunistic when it comes to food. And what I talked about earlier about surviving through the winter, this is how woodpeckers possibly survive through the winter. There are a number of late fruiting trees and shrubs that have berries and other fruits in October, November. They're able to feed on that and keep their energy levels up. And of course, they must be finding some dormant larvae and eggs that they feed on as well. There are some reports of woodpeckers even eating small birds like tiny mice and snakes. That brings me to the importance of dead wood. A lot of our forest managers, a lot of our park managers don't think that dead wood is important, but birds like woodpeckers really need dead wood and snags. By snags, I mean standing dead trees. And deadwood is important because when it rots in the forest, when a tree falls and rots in the forest, there's a whole collection of insects and arthropods that feed on the rotting wood. And that's where the woodpecker will go to get its snack. So very important to leave some dead wood in the forest for these birds. Back to nesting. So, as I talked earlier, there is a lot of participation of both the parents in the incubation and feeding of the bird. The incubation period is generally about 2 to 3 weeks, depending on the size of the bird. Fledging takes place in 18 to 30 days. And it is something about which the Indian woodpeckers have hardly been observed nesting. I'm now going to show you the video, a very rare video taken by Raman Kumar, who studies the great slaty woodpecker. Nisha, can you turn on the video?
Yeah.
So you can see now the bird. You can see the bird fledging. Oh, somebody asked what is fledging. So fledging is when the chicks are just come out of the nest and are learning to fly. So they're out of the nest. What is interesting about this video is that it's possibly the only video of this really rare woodpecker. And Raman continues to work on this very important species. You can see the perfectly symmetrical cavity that it's made, how it's regurgitating the food it's eaten and feeding it to the young from outside. This is something that needs to be done for a lot of our species. We don't know what they actually need, how they nest, how long it takes, and so on. So because of virtue of making these cavities or holes, very often woodpeckers are referred to as ecosystem engineers. There's another animal that is often called an ecosystem engineer, and that is the beaver. The beaver will cut a tree and create a little lake for itself by cutting a tree and putting it across a running stream, which creates habitat for many other species. Similarly, woodpeckers create these cavities. And there are an umpteen number of animals and birds that use these cavities, some of them for nesting. You have snakes, squirrels, and lizards. You have a lot of birds. In our own study site in Kumau, we have seen so many cavity nesters. Of course, we have not seen their cavities, but based on the behavior which is recorded. So you have lots of small owls, you have nuthatches, these parakeets-like holes. So in many parts of the country, you'll find many of these groups, owlets, nuthatches, parakeets, and flycatchers, making use of the holes that the woodpeckers are creating and often abandoning for the next season. So the woodpeckers seem to find it very easy to make the cavity. We might see it as very hard. These guys create cavities all the time. So you can imagine how many hundreds of cavities there are in the forest just by virtue of having woodpeckers there. And so the woodpeckers are playing a very important role as ecosystem engineers. They're also called keystone species. By keystone, people refer to the doorway of an old building where one single stone really holds it all together, the doorway arch. So if you take out that stone, the whole doorway falls apart. Similarly, here, if you look at this picture and you imagine the black circle to be a woodpecker and the purples to be species that are depending on the woodpecker by virtue of nesting in its cavities, and other species like these two purples that depend on the species that make, that use the cavities made by the woodpecker. And then these two orange circles that depict species that woodpeckers depend on. Supposing in this small part of a food web, the woodpecker is taken out, either because the habitat is not suitable or it's hunted out. You can imagine what happens to all of these other species. So it kind of collapses. The only thing you have left are the two species that the woodpecker depended on. And these two species will probably experience other changes that. So from 8 species, you're down to 2. And that's why, you know, intuitively, when we started, all started looking at woodpeckers and really observing them, we felt that this is a very important group to save and to study. I'll take you through a few very interesting behaviors that woodpeckers show. One is the rufous woodpecker, which is seen all over the Terai and in the moist forests of the east and in the eastern and western Himalayan foothills. And it has the strangest habit of making its nest inside an ant nest, if you can believe that. This is a tree ant which bites really hard. Those of you who may have bumped into tree ants in the forest would realize how badly they sting. But this woodpecker just goes inside, kills the ants inside, leaves the rest, makes its little hole and nests inside. People still don't know why the ants don't bite the rufous woodpecker, because they can sting really badly. Apparently there is some perfume that the, or a stinking perfume that the birds are doused in that keeps the ants away. But it's also far more romantic to think about other reasons why the rufous woodpecker has this behavior. So I set my mind thinking and I said, if the pangolins and the sloth bear come in to attack the nest, the rufous woodpecker is going to give them a nice beating with its sharp beak. So the nest gets protection from these other predators. And in return, the ants are willing to let this woodpecker stay inside. It's slightly far-fetched, but then evolution is kind of funny as well. And here, green humor has their own interpretation. There's free Wi-Fi in here, maybe. So I'm happy, you're happy. There's this acorn woodpecker, which has this granary. This lives in the southwestern United States, and this is supposed to be a tree which it uses as a granary. So each of those round dots is an acorn from the oak, the seed of the oak, that it is storing into small holes. It has specially been carved out by this bird along with its family members. It's quite an amazing thing that it does. So you would wonder, why not just create one cavity and keep dumping the oaks in the acorns into that cavity, because it's also much less visible to robbers, right? Apparently, it has figured out that the best humidity and the temperature at which the oaks will stay out the winter is in these holes where they are slightly exposed to the elements rather than inside a cavity. Quite amazing. This is something that people are studying frantically, trying to figure out how this evolved. Of course, our own team has been looking a lot at forest change. As all of you know, we have lots of forest in India, but unfortunately, the forests are in different conditions. What looks as forest from the satellites may not be in very good shape. For instance, here on the left, you see good oak forest. In the middle, you see a forest which is heavily used by people for firewood and grazing. And on the right, you see this teak plantation where the forest has been removed and teak has been planted, which is used as a commercial wood. And the lot of us who've been roaming these forests have been wondering, how does forest change actually affect woodpeckers? So in Corbett Park, where Raman did his PhD, and I was helping him with that, he did a whole lot of surveys in Corbett Park in different kinds of habitat. And he had two really interesting results. One is that large species like the greater yellowknave and the gray-headed woodpecker do not occur in plantations at all. They just stick to the good forest, the tall, dense forest, where they are able to get all their food and the trees are big enough to have cavities. The other very interesting result that Raman had was that in summer, the woodpeckers stick to the really good forest for nesting. Because they need to feed their young, they need some space, they need to keep their territories. However, in winter, they get out into poorer habitats, which are not so good for insects, such as plantations and worked forest, younger regenerating forest. So you need old growth forests. That was one lesson. Of course, a lot of you who have been birding for a long time probably know this, but it was good to see it in reality and in quantitative ways. Later on, Raman did the Great Slaty Woodpecker Survey, and he looked at Old Sal Forest. We got a grant from the World Wildlife Fund, and he did very intensive sampling for the Great Slaty Woodpecker in the areas of Haridwar, Rishikesh, Rajaji area. Here you can see the green area depicts the forest in southern Uttarakhand. The blue dots indicate the areas where he surveyed, and the red dots are the places where Great Slaty was actually seen. And as you can see, out of that entire area that was surveyed, only out of 50 sites that were surveyed, only 7 had any signs of Great Slaty. And all the surveys were done in places with appropriate sizes of trees where the habitat was apparently good for them. So what is it about the habitat that keeps them away from many of these areas? And that set us thinking that this species could be especially vulnerable when we are working the forest, we are making roads through them, we are creating edges with lots of disturbance. Maybe they are afraid of people. Maybe they are disturbed by the traffic noises. We don't know yet. And talking about large woodpeckers like Great Slaty, I want to talk about a couple of woodpeckers. It's interesting, the two woodpeckers went extinct as recently as mid-20th century. The ivory-billed woodpecker, which inhabited the swamp forests of southern United States, was last seen in 1944. It was only slightly smaller than the Great Slaty woodpecker. The imperial woodpecker of Mexico, which was specializing on the pine forests of the mountains of Mexico. Again, a group living species, highly specialized, last seen in 1956 in Mexico. So within the last century, we've lost two large woodpeckers. But I want to leave on a cheery note. I want you to guess the identity of this widespread and familiar species of woodpecker in India. It has a lovely, cheery call that you may have heard from time to time. So you can write your answer in the chat box. Wow, almost everyone's got it. Great. So I'm glad to know that people have know this woodpecker. It really is. It is a bird that I've also been seeing, even though I grew up in a concrete jungle of Delhi. It's a bird that I used to see every morning in my garden. It is so adaptable and it is so very colorful. It really inspires young people to start looking at birds from a young age. great species to grow up with. That's the one, black rump flameback. Look out for it next time you go to the neighborhood park. Very resilient bird. I want to leave you with the cheery thought of saving woodpeckers. It's very much possible if we look after our forests. I want to thank and show my collaborators on the top left corner, Jagdish Negi, who's a recent training, Tarun Menon, who's been working with me for almost 3 years now, on and off, and Rito Broto, who interned with me for 2 tough seasons, Raman Kumar, my old friend and collaborator, and Raj Kamal Goswami, who's now with Atri, who works in Meghalaya. I hope that they've all become interested in woodpeckers because of all the experiences we've had together. Truly is a magical set of birds. I want to thank all our partners and supporters. Uttarakhand Forest Department has been really, really cooperative all these years. And they've given us permits. They've allowed us to stay wherever we wanted. SEDAR, my parent organization, Department of Science and Technology, Wildlife Conservation Society, Center for Wildlife Studies, NCBS and WWF India. If I've left out anyone, I apologize. It's been a long time and I hope that we will keep going with more and more people joining my team. Thank you for being here.
All right, that was a lovely presentation, Ghazala. It was super, super interesting. And we'll quickly do a quiz now before we open the floor to questions. Let me share my screen. So for those of you who've attended our previous sessions, you guys might know the drill already. Please locate the yes and no buttons under the participants list. And I'll read out a fact. And you have to tell me if it's true or false. So if it's true, please click on the yes button under the participants list. And if it's false, please click on the no button under the participants list. And I hope Ghazala will help me in answering the questions. All right, so I hope you found the yes and no buttons. So here's the first question. All woodpeckers live in pairs. Is it true or is it false? All woodpeckers live in pairs. So 27 people say yes and 59 people say no. Ghazala, would you like to tell us the answer?
Yeah. A number of woodpeckers live in groups that consist of the parents and the young of the previous year, who often work as helpers in nesting. That includes the imperial woodpecker that I showed, the great slaty, some of the larger woodpeckers. Some of the smaller woodpeckers have also been seen in groups, but nobody has really found out how they operate. But yeah, there are pairs and there are flocks.
Okay. The next question. Only the female woodpecker feeds the young during nesting. Is that true or is that false? So we have some 12 people saying yes, that it's true, and some 76 people saying that it's false.
Yeah, so Yeah, I think I talked about this in the presentation also. Yeah, the males are rather emancipated, so they do help in the rearing of the young in many species.
Great. So the next...
It's a really interesting anecdote about how some woodpeckers, the males take the night shift. So that means the females get to have a night, girl's night out.
That's interesting. Okay, so the third question. And yeah, Ghazala has talked about this in her talk. Hornbills often nest in tree holes made by woodpeckers. Some 57 yeses and 22 noes.
Hornbills are known to make use of nests created by woodpeckers. Of course, hornbills also are able to, kind of refashion those cavities. They also make use of certain rotted tree branches or crooks of tree branches where they're able to carve out. But definitely they do make use of tree holes made by woodpeckers also.
All right, next question. Woodpeckers never descend to the ground. Again, Ghazala has talked about this in her talk. Woodpeckers never descend to the ground. They never come to the ground. Yep, most of you are saying that it's false. Some 90 people are saying no, and 9 people say yes.
Yeah, good. So they were paying attention.
Yeah. All right. The answer is no, because they do come to the ground. And then the next question. Woodpeckers sometimes feed on nectar and berries and not just insects. Yep, everyone's got this.
Yeah, I think I talk too much about it.
Yeah. Lovely. Lots of yeses. I mean, all yeses. All right. So coming to the bonus round, and I'll ask my colleagues Abhishek and Garima to help me with this. Please don't raise your hands just yet. So I'm going to read out a question, and please raise your hand if you know the answer. And my colleagues, Abhishek and Garima, will randomly mute someone who has raised their hand. And if they answer correctly, we have a prize for them. And so that's about it. So I hope everyone's ready for the first question. Abhishek, are you geared up?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah.
All right. I hope everyone got the instructions. And the raise hand option is located under the participants list, as I've depicted here. All right. Quickly moving on to the first question. Name two endemic woodpeckers found in the Indian subcontinent. Endemic meaning that they're found only in the Indian subcontinent and nowhere else.
Hi everyone, my name is Himanshu. So the one is the Himalayan woodpecker, and second one is the gray-capped pygmy woodpecker.
The second one is?
Gray-capped pygmy woodpecker.
Ghazal, is that the correct answer?
Gray-capped is not correct.
Okay. So would anyone... thanks, Himanshu. Would anyone like to venture the second name? The Himalayan woodpecker is the correct answer.
Yeah, I'll unmute someone else. Sorry, I'm unable to unmute. Just give me a second.
Should I quickly do that? Or should I quickly unmute someone?
Yes, you can.
All right.
Hi, this is Tina, brown-fronted woodpecker.
No.
That's correct.
Oh, is that correct?
Yeah. Brown-fronted and Himalayan are both endemic to the Indian subcontinent. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Great. So, Tina and Himanshu, please privately in the chat box, you can message us your address and phone number.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, what are they getting?
Yeah. And they'll get a set of early bird bookmarks.
Cool.
All right, moving on to the next question. Name a country which has no woodpeckers at all. Abhi, are you unmuting anyone?
I'm unable to do it. Maybe you would like to try.
Let me try. Yeah, somehow even I'm unable to do it. Let me see.
Oh, I can't see people.
Okay, I can do it if you guys are unable to.
Yeah, please.
Do that? Yeah, let me just pick somebody at random.
Is it Antarctica?
Oops, who is that?
Antarctica?
Could you tell us?
That's not a country. That's not a country.
Yeah, not a country.
North America?
Yogeshwari.
North America?
Country, not continent. Yeah.
Okay, let me try somebody else.
One person wrote in the right answer.
My name is Sujit Sharma. Is it Greenland?
Greenland is not a country. It comes under as an autonomous territory of another country. Denmark.
Anjali.
Egypt.
Not the right answer.
Has somebody been selected to answer the question?
Yes, she guessed Egypt, which is not the right answer.
Hello.
Not the right answer.
Is it Iceland?
This is Madhavi, it's Australia.
Yeah.
Yes. So Madhavi has the
Iceland?
Right. Who's this? Who's speaking? Who said who answered Iceland?
This is me, Gridi Ripati.
Okay. Well,
hello,
Ghazala, would you like to comment on that?
No, Iceland is will have a few woodpeckers.
Yeah, so I think Madhvi is...
Yes, Australia is correct.
Given the
I
right
saw some
answer.
People writing New Zealand, which is also correct. Chat box.
Yeah, I forgot. Disabled chat box.
Madagascar, interestingly, has no woodpeckers.
Wow. Yeah. All right, so thank you everyone for participating in the quiz. Madhavi, Tina, and Himanshu, please privately message us your address and phone number. And we'll send you a set of early bird bookmarks. And now we're opening the floor to questions. So please type any question you may have in the chat box.
The questions shall be screened for coherence.
Yeah, so there were a few questions during your talk, which I'll address. Someone asked if you could comment more on the nest site selection of woodpeckers.
Yeah, so unfortunately, there's not a lot of work on nest site selection. So Raman's work did show that he looked at cavities and what kind of trees there were, nests were being made. So woodpeckers do select trees for their size, obviously. And they would need a particular size of tree in which they can create a large cavity, because from the hole, the cavity looks really small, but inside there is a substantial area that is required for the entire woodpecker family. So yes, I think the size of the tree is very important. And from our work on the habitat selection, different species do select based on the density of the forest, the cover, the amount of shade present, the number of trees present. Different woodpeckers have slightly differing requirements. But in general, many of the woodpeckers need to find a dense cluster of trees in which they can start nesting. They may be responding to the kind of physical characteristics of the trees and so on.
Okay, another question that came during the talk was, do woodpeckers change their cavity from one year to the next?
Unfortunately, there's not enough data on this, but it seems like they make a new cavity every year. The old cavities may be used for roosting, but it seems like in the breeding season, new cavities are made every breeding season. That's how a large number of other species are able to come in and use these cavities. We've seen a lot of those.
Okay. Shanti is asking, why don't these countries have woodpeckers? Australia, New Zealand, why don't they have woodpeckers?
So Australia, if you know about marsupials, Australia has a completely different fauna from the rest of the world, because the area of Australia separated from the rest of the continent way back before even a lot of species started evolving. So woodpeckers as a group didn't reach there. Australia is also far from other countries. New Zealand, it would be the same reason. Madagascar, I'm not so sure. I'm not sure about the evolutionary history. But there it could be to do with a certain amount with the competition that they face. The primates in Madagascar are totally arboreal. They are very, very tree loving. And there might be an element of competition there. But at the same time, Madagascar also is island, oceanic island. It's far from the continent of Africa. So the birds never reached there and never evolved there, that particular group. From the presentation, you may have made out that woodpeckers are not a group that moves a lot, that disperses a lot like other species. And so there are a lot more endemism in woodpeckers. They are not very strong flying species. They're not very long distance flyers. So that could be one of the reasons they are no woodpeckers in certain islands.
Okay, Arun is asking about local migration of woodpeckers in the Himalayas, altitudinal or...
Yeah, so a lot of people feel that there is some amount of altitudinal migration in winter, and it has been written about in Dillon and Ripley. However, our own studies show Tarun and Ritu both have spent almost 4 seasons in the Himalayas. And in the winter, we don't see a very different number of lot of woodpeckers that we see in summer. So we feel like there's not a lot of migration. However, if you go up the mountains, you go to higher areas like 3,000 meters, 4,000 meters where the conifers are, those areas could be showing seasonal migrations. Yeah, but short distance ones, not very, very long distance ones like other birds.
Okay, so this question I'm sure a lot of other people will also have. Kriti is saying, once I saw a black-rumped flameback knocking a car's rear view mirror. Why so?
Actually, I don't know. And I've had hornbills dive bombing my window very often here in Singapore. It's because they are trying to find out if, you know, there are competitors, you know, and they might see it as a territorial aggression. You know, they might think there's another woodpecker out there and trying to scare that one off. But yeah, it's open to be investigated by behavioral ecologists.
Deepak is asking, are there any similarities between the habits of woodpeckers and hoopoe? Their head shape is quite similar. Many people mistakenly call the hoopoe a woodpecker.
Yeah, very often. Hoopoes are completely different family of birds. Their beak is just very pointed, but it's just not tough enough. They don't have the musculature or the bone strength to create cavities. You may see them sometimes nesting in small holes in branches or in, you know, in old buildings even, where there are little cavities, but they cannot make holes. Also, they feed only on the ground. You'll never see them feeding on trees. So a very different family. But they're also insectivores. Yeah, they take out a lot of insects from the ground.
Okay. Chandra is asking, what variety of trees do sapsuckers depend on to feed that can generate sap in India?
Okay, so that's really interesting question. So we had observed in the oak forest at least, so the sapsuckers, I mean, in India, the rufous-bellied woodpecker is the only sapsucker. It lives in the mid-altitudinal oak forests and subtropical forests of the Himalayas, which is about 1,500 meters to about 2,500 meters. And all of the e-bird sightings are from that. Within that forest, which is oak forest, oak-dominated forest, we found sap holes on at least 7 or 8 species. And the most commonly used one is the Banj oak, which is a very important tree at that altitude. It's an oak tree. It's got a lot of sap, obviously. And the tree that I showed was a toon tree, Tuna ciliata. And this occurs slightly lower in elevation than the oak forest. So it's around the same area. So yeah, we looked around a lot. We only found 10 or 12 individuals with any holes. And most of these are oak trees, yeah.
And Shanti is asking if sap sucking impacts the life of the tree.
It doesn't seem to. Most of the trees that we've seen with holes are doing very well. Because what happens is that the bark grows out. The holes that are made are very, very superficial. So they're able to use that. They don't go in very deep. And within a year or two, the bark grows back and the tree, it doesn't seem to affect the tree, least in the short term.
Okay. And Navneet is asking if there are any books on woodpeckers in India.
Not yet. Lot to do out there. If some of you would like to, plenty to do, plenty to write. And lots of species that are very little known.
Okay, Sushmita is asking, do piculets also bore holes in trees for nesting?
Yes, they do. They are able to carve out small holes.
Okay. Suhit is asking the lifespan of woodpeckers.
I don't really know, but from the size of the bird, it would seem to be at least the large woodpeckers probably would live for more than 15, 20 years.
Okay.
All ones, yeah, we don't really know.
And Himanshu is asking, apart from deforestation, what are the natural, who are the natural predators of woodpeckers?
Very interesting. So we can only guess, but from our observations, there are a number of small mammals and reptiles that can prey on the eggs and the young ones of woodpeckers very easily. For instance, I've seen the yellow-throated marten in the oak forest going and searching a lot of cavities for nests. And they're very clever animals. Once they find the cavities, they'll go search them frequently, because if they're not woodpeckers, there'll be something else nesting in that. So there are weasels, there are martens, there may be rats, there could be monitor lizards, snakes that go in and feed. So there are possibly a lot of predators. I think Raman has done some work on that, which he's continuing.
All right. Paul has a rather long question. Do woodpeckers use excretion to scare away other birds from their territory? I have observed a rufous-bellied woodpecker excreting when there were other woodpecker species on the same tree. Rufous-bellied woodpecker seems to be aggressive towards the other species, as well as another male who came to the same tree. Or do they excrete out of stress or just releasing waste?
Wow, that's a really neat observation. Needs to be published. As I told you, lots to find out. I've never seen that happen myself. If it's true, it would be really interesting. And yes, rufous-bellied do tend to be quite aggressive, especially when they are breeding. They scare away other pairs and other woodpeckers from the area.
Are woodpeckers in forest a sign of a healthy forest?
A lot of woodpeckers, yes. Yeah, not every woodpecker. As I mentioned in my talk, some of the smaller woodpeckers particularly are quite adaptive, and they can live. But that's again a generalization. There are small woodpeckers like, say, the brown-capped pygmy woodpecker that we observe in the Aravallis that doesn't really, you know, it's a tiny bird and it could actually feed off of a lot of different sources, but it lives only in really good forest in the Aravallis. Similarly, so every species is quite different, but on the whole, I would say an abundance of woodpeckers and a variety of woodpeckers indicates a healthy forest ecosystem.
Taukeer is asking, kya sabhi size ke woodpeckers ke bachche 18 se 30 din mein udne lagte hain?
हाँ, छोटे वुडपेकर्स 15 दिन में हो जाते हैं और बड़े वुडपेकर्स 30 दिन तक टाइम लगता है. तो रेंज मैंने रेंज दिया था 18 से 30 दिन के बीच का स्पीशीज के लिए.
ओके, गरिमा और अभिषेका, डिड आई मिस एनी क्वेश्चंस? Oh, and we're also running out of time, so I guess we'll end here itself. I'm seeing that like a lot of people have a lot of other questions also.
Yeah, very interesting observations are coming up.
Yeah, so you can write to us on social media platforms in Ghazala. I'm sure you'll be happy to answer them later. But for now, we'll have to close the session. So thank you everyone for attending. Thank you, Ghazala, for the amazing talk. I mean, I'm sure we all learned a lot, and there's so much more to know about these birds. For future updates and updates about our sessions, you can all follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. We also have a website. All our previous sessions have been uploaded on YouTube, and all these links have been shared by Garima on in the chat box. And we also have a very interesting session in English again next Sunday at the same time. So please stay tuned in for that.
Thank you, everyone. And I hope that you would be inspired to observe woodpeckers more and also enjoy birds much more. And thank you for your lovely observations and interest in woodpeckers. Thank you for attending.